We are at the offering time. We're going to have somebody who went to the Dominican Republic 2 weeks ago kind of tell us what's been going on with your money there. Very, very exciting to see what we're doing all over the world. And we have a neat conversation today out of the book of Mark about something that Jesus said that caught me off guard. So I'm going to begin the service, though, in the book of Zechariah. And I've been reading through the minor prophets, and sometimes the minor prophets can be hard to wrap your head around because you're not sure whether they're talking about what's going on then or whether they're talking about the coming of Christ or whether they're talking about the second coming of Christ. It can be very confusing. Well, at the end of chapter 8 in the book of Zechariah, there's a wonderful scripture, and it is about us. This is not about the Jews, even though it says Jew, and I'll tell you why. It says, this is what the Lord Almighty says. In those days, 10 people from all languages and nations will take firm hold of one Jew by the hem of his robe and say, let us go with you because we have heard that God is with you. Now, I know it says that they're going to grab a Jew, but remember in the New Testament, Paul reminds us that we are the grafted in Jews. And in Jesus' time, they were not seeking after the Christians, asking them, hey, what's God doing? They were murdering them. Okay, so I know that this is talking about the end times, which we are living in. And I know that this is a picture that God has given us of what our life in Christ should look like. And if we are willing to follow Christ, if we are willing to serve him, if we really have him on the throne of our lives, the people in our lives will want to know why we have the peace and the hope and the joy, even in the midst of a broken world. And that's what God is encouraging us to. So let's pray. Lord, we just praise you because you love us. Because you saved us, because you made us, because you've got this wonderful plan for us, Lord. And that plan includes a blessing of having people drawn to you through us if we'll follow you, if we'll serve you, if we'll put you first. We thank you for the opportunity, Lord. And we pray that today, as we learn your word, as we worship you, as we sing, as we pray, Lord, we pray that it might be your spirit that speaks. Father, that we would be built up and connected to you, and we would hear your voice. Lord, and it would help us. Help us to focus on you more. Help us to love this world around us. Help us to paint a picture of this world for Jesus. We thank you. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let's worship God this morning.
Being you ever rescued me, singing out, Jesus is alive. together for my good. You make all things work together for my good. And that's why I sing your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your love is devoted like a ring of solid gold, like a vow that is tested, like a covenant of old. Your love is enduring through the winter rain and the beyond the horizon. Merciful today, faithful you. Faithful you will be. Pledge yourself to me. And that's why I sing your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Father, the orphan, your kindness makes us whole. You shoulder our weakness, strength becomes our own. You're making me like you, clothing me in white. By her name, that's why I sing your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips. Be on my lips. You will be praised. You will be praised with angels and saints. We sing, worthy are you, Lord. You will be praised. You will be praised. Be on my lips.
I love this song. The one line says, I'm feeling satisfied because of you, only you, Jesus. And I think one of the greatest struggles we have in this world is that we try to find satisfaction in all kinds of other things. And the only thing that will satisfy our heart is Jesus. And so I think that's the root of most of our struggles. We have a God-sized hole in our heart that we try to fit lots of other things in. If there's something going on in your life that's pulling you away from God, or there's something going on in your life that's causing you to hurt, there's something going on in your life that this isn't the way it's supposed to be, Jesus is the only answer. The Word says that we fall to our knees, we pray to Him, and He hears. So the altar's open. There's people up here to pray with you and for you. Don't miss an opportunity, because it's only Jesus that has the answers to what ails us. It's time to pray.
I'm coming back to life. I'm feeling
Lord, we praise you. I praise you for hope. I love the word hope, Lord. We live in a world that is so devoid of hope. We teach people that there is no God, and the world talks about man being the only hope, and we see that the world is hopeless because we've taken you out of everything, Lord. We know that Jesus is the hope. And Father, I pray that we would know that hope. I pray that we would focus on that hope. I pray that we would talk about that hope. I pray that we would be that hope in this world because people need hope to rise. Father, you have told us that we're going to be the source, that your Spirit will work through us as we go into this world and minister. And so, Lord, I pray that we would be those people. And I pray that we would know that hope. And I pray that we, when we are beat up and when we are struggling, we would realize that there's no greater reality than the cross and the resurrection that guarantees that hope. And Father, that you are the King of hope. Father, we just give you praise and glory for all that you are. We love you. Help us to serve you. Shine your light in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. So, we have been moving through the book of Mark, and we've been studying things that Jesus said that are strange or confrontive or surprising. And I wish Pritchard hadn't done this, but now the sermon series is called Jesus Said What? I guess it's good. You all laugh every time, so. And in chapter 8 of Mark, Jesus says something that really is surprising. In fact, there's no way to get around what Jesus says to Peter. He calls Peter Satan. And he doesn't say you're acting like Satan. He doesn't say, you know, you're helping the devil. He says, get behind me, Satan. And then he says, you don't have the thing in mind the things of God, but the things of man. So we know he's talking to Peter. Okay? Very, very confrontive and rather harsh. And when we look at the relationship that Jesus had with the disciples and we think about that word disciple being carried on to us, we're disciples. We're called to disciple people. That phrase, get behind me, Satan, really kind of shocked me to think that Jesus would say that to one of his disciples. So let's dig in to what's going on when he said this. A very short section today, chapter 8, verses 27 to 33 is all. And we'll start in 27 through 30 and look at kind of what led up to Jesus holding Peter to this level of accountability. It says in verse 27 of chapter 8 of Mark, Jesus and his disciples went on to the villages around Caesarea Philippi. On the way, he asked them, who do people say that I am? They replied, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others, one of the prophets. But what about you, he asked, who do you say I am? Peter answered, you are the Messiah. Jesus warned them not to tell anyone about him. Okay, so this kind of sets up the 7 or 8 verses we're going to deal with today. But there's a couple things I want you to notice, because when we get to verse 33 and Jesus calls Peter Satan, it is shocking. And what we need to know is kind of what's going on here. If we were right at the beginning of Jesus' ministry, I don't know that Jesus would have said this to Peter, okay? But we're not. In fact, we're in a very intense time of ministry in Mark chapter 8. Mark chapter 8 begins with Jesus feeding the 4,000, and then Jesus goes on to heal the blind man at Bethsaida. And Bethsaida is about 20 miles from Caesarea Philippi. So when it says they went on to there, it kind of connects it to the rest of the chapter. And it's in this series of things that Jesus is doing, probably a day or two later, for them to go from village to village. Okay, so it's not like the disciples weren't witnessing what Jesus was doing and who Jesus was. It's not like Jesus caught him off guard and said, all right, right now, tell me who I am, and if you fail, you're going to hell. I mean, they were in the middle of Jesus's, probably his most intense time of ministry, and they were right in the middle of it. And, by the way, it's 3 weeks before the cross, give or take. Okay, some of the timing isn't exact. They don't count as many days, and it skips around. But it's no more than a few weeks before the cross, a month at the most. Okay, so a time is going on when they're intensely into ministry, and a time is coming when they're going to have to take over for Jesus. Okay, so it's not out of place for him to want to make sure that they've got it straight who he is. Hey, these aren't questions out of left field, and these guys should know the answers to these questions. Okay, it should be fresh in their minds, both practically, his power, and symbolically, his place. I mean, if you think about it, there's a dozen places in the Gospels where Jesus does something, and the Pharisees say, well, only God can do that, and Jesus says, uh-huh. I mean, it should be pretty well understood by these guys at this point. Okay? Now, it's not, but Jesus is getting them there. But part of getting them there is holding them accountable when they don't know the answers, which is really what happens at the end. Okay, so he's trying to get them where they need to be, and really they should have some inkling about this. Okay, I like that because that's really where we are. You know, if you go on the missions field and you visit people, and there still are people out there who've not heard the name of Jesus a lot, You can't hold them accountable. Even in our world, in our culture now, there's kids who maybe didn't grow up in Christian homes and haven't been exposed to a lot of Christian things, okay? But that's not most of the people in this room. Most of us, when we get to the part about God confronting Peter, most of us can be held to this standard. We know who Christ is. So it's important to recognize that that's what's going on before he busts Peter up. Peter should know this. Okay, so they go on to do some ministry, and Jesus takes the opportunity as they're traveling to have a discussion. And he says, so, what's the word on the street about me? Who do people say I am? What are people saying about me? Now, I couldn't help but wonder why. Why does he want to know what people are saying? Because, you know, we think of, this is an important question if you're building a church. Okay, but Jesus isn't building a church. In fact, there's times when Jesus has all these followers and he purposely does things to thin them out. And he tells people all the time, don't tell anybody about me. Okay, so Jesus isn't trying to build a church. Now, he is trying to put the dominoes in place so that when he ascends, the disciples can then build the church and those dominoes fall. So he is casting seed. Okay, but he's not necessarily trying to gather followers, so who cares what people think of him? I think there's a couple of reasons that he wants to know why what people are saying about him. The first one, I think he wants to see if the message is clear. He wants to see if they're getting it. Are people actually understanding what he's teaching, what he's doing, and what's happening? Okay, and it's important. It's important that the message is clear. Okay, now, the other thing I think is he wants to check on the progress of the ministry. You know, at the end of this, he tells the disciples not to tell anybody, but in verse 30, and that happens throughout the Gospels where he says to people, hey, don't tell anybody about me. Now, they always do. Why does he say that? Most of the time he says that because he wants to ensure that the timing of God works out. You know, there's one place where Jesus says he had to withdraw because the people were going to make him king by force. So he's always intensely aware of what's going on as he's doing ministry because he wants God's timing to be fulfilled. So in a way, I think he wants to know what people think because people matter. I also think he's trying to take the temperature, as it were, of the ministry because 3 weeks from now he goes to the cross. Okay, so those are two reasons. I think the biggest reason is that he's setting Peter up for the question, the very same question. And it's kind of amusing. You know, all of us, I jokingly said first service, all of us find it easier to talk about other things people, churches, than ourselves, isn't it? Look at, we could just go from here all the way down Sunset, across the river, and all the way down Pennsylvania Avenue. And I can tell you what every church along the way is doing wrong. Not this church, we're perfect. Yeah, see, it's easy to look out there, but we don't want to look in here. The truth is, every problem they got, we got too. You know why? Church is made up of people. We're all broken and sinful. But Jesus starts out with, hey, what do they think? Peter's got all kinds of answers. Okay? Then Jesus says, yeah, what about you? Okay, now, Peter answers correctly. That's important to know. We'll get there in a minute. Okay, so I think those are three of the reasons that Jesus even cares about the question. Here's the other thing. I think he's giving us something to use as a tool in ministry, because the answers to these questions matter greatly for us. Who do people say Jesus is? You know what? We better know where people are with Christ before we try to minister to them. Because an angry atheist who doesn't believe there's a God, and someone who believes that there's something, they know there's got to be something more, but they're not sure what that looks like. You minister to those two people very, very differently. It takes a different amount of time. It takes a different approach. It takes, they're very different. Okay, so we better know the answer to number one. Okay, what do people, you know how to witness? We need to know how to witness to people. So the first reason Jesus asked was to see if they're getting it. We need to know where they're at. Okay, and the second reason, to kind of check the temperature, as we build those relationships and as we do ministry with and for people, we need to know how that relationship is moving forward. If we've befriended that angry atheist to the point that they're seeing some differences in us that they don't understand, maybe then it's time to pop the question. Or maybe then it's time to invite them to church. Or maybe it's time to change the conversation. But we need to constantly check the temperature of those ministry relationships that we have. Okay? And finally, he was setting Peter up to ask the question. I think he's setting up us up to ask us the question. Because if we're going to ask other people where they're at with Christ, it is very, very logical for us to then look in the mirror and say, hey, wait a minute. Where am I with Christ? Now, I think it's interesting that they respond to him with three different pieces of information. Some say Elijah, and some say John the Baptist, and others say one of the prophets, okay? But they frame their answer in terms of some very Jewish things, and I think that's important to note, okay? And I'm going to get to that in a minute, but the same question, he then turns and asks Peter the same question. And I'm going to tell you, this is, even though this is a short scripture, this might be one of the most important things that we ever deal with. Because the answer to this question, who do you say Jesus is? Really, I don't want to say it's the most important question. Okay, it's the most important question you will ever deal with, that you will ever ask yourself. You know, most of us don't realize how philosophical we are. You say the word philosophy and people are like, oh no, okay? We are all philosophical. All of us make decisions and deal with life based on basic assumptions. And that's all philosophy is an understanding of logically where those basic assumptions come from. You want a different word? I'll give you a better word, worldview. Instead of the word philosophy, use the word worldview. It's the same thing. But all of us have a worldview. And this question, who do you say Jesus is? It is the most basic question of your worldview. And the problem is, a lot of us don't realize how influential our worldview or views are to our decision-making process. And what happens is we take in lots of worldviews, and sometimes they're not compatible, but we still use them, okay? We have a worldview that says everyone should be happy, okay? And we use that when we make decisions about some things, okay? But then we have another worldview that says there's a God in heaven, and he should be in charge. And we use that worldview when we make other decisions, and that makes us hypocrites. We dealt with that last week. So when you boil down how you make decisions and how you view the world to the most simple, the most basic thought, it starts at the beginning. And in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The most basic decision we'll ever make is there a God? If there's not a God, then this, then this, then this. If there is a God, then this, then this, then this. It's the most basic. So this question, who do you say Jesus is? He's God in the flesh. And if he's God in the flesh, and God in the flesh died for you and rose for you. Now see, this begins to color what I think and what I do and how I live and how I act. And so this is a really, really important question that all of us, every single Christian, no matter how long you've been a Christian, or even if you're not a Christian, we all have to deal with this question, God or no God? Yes, okay, is Jesus God? It's the most basic. Now, here's the problem. Most of us understand who Jesus was. Otherwise, you wouldn't be here. And if you don't, you're at least willing or open to hear about it because you're sitting here. Okay? So, we say, who's Jesus? Well, he's God in the flesh, and he died for our sins. He rose again, he's given us the Holy Spirit. He's got a plan for us. Okay, all of that's your basic assumption. Great. It was Peter's, and in three verses, he's going to be called Satan. So clearly, that's not enough. Okay? I was reading, and this is why the fact that all of their answers were Jewish, Elijah and John the Baptist and a prophet of old, they were all Jewish answers. This is what made me think about what I'm about to say. I was reading through Exodus the other day, and I saw a verse in Exodus that I don't know how I had not seen this verse. I've read through the Bible at least 20 times, and I've preached out of Exodus. I've been through Exodus. I don't know how I missed this. But in Exodus 24, it says that Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 elders from Israel went up the mountain and they saw the God of Israel. And under his feet was something like a permanent, like pavement made of sapphire, clear as the sky itself. It says they saw him and they ate and they drank and they worshiped. And God did not smite them. That's how I know they actually saw him, because it says, if you see God, you'll die. But these guys saw God and didn't die. 74 elders from Israel. You know what happens? So clearly, they know who God is. They saw him face to face. You know what happens next? 73 of those guys go down the mountain and make a golden calf. I'm not kidding. Exodus 33. In between, the only thing that happens is that God, Jesus, or Moses is up on the mountain getting stuff from God. It's basically the description of all the things that God gave to Moses. But the 73 elders, they see God, they walk down the mountain, and they make a golden calf. Okay? So you can know who God is. And I know in our culture, we think knowledge is power. It's not power. Doing what you know is power. Power requires some action, okay? Just knowing who Jesus is, you can answer the question correctly and still not do what he says. And I think we think that we're smart and we'll find some ways around it. And this is what made me think about the Jews. Those elders, they knew that. You know, in the Bible, in the Old Testament, there's about 50 different names for God. God is called all kinds of cool things. And some of the names for God, they all reflect different parts of his character. But here's the problem. We take parts of him and we make that our whole. See, God's name in the Bible is Yahweh. In the Old Testament, he's called Yahweh. And that's his personal name, like Bob or Fred or Tom, Yahweh. He likes Yahweh. You know why? Because he wants us to be on a first name basis with him. It doesn't mean that we're equal to him. He can still smite us anytime because he's God and he's on a throne and we're not. But he wants us to know him because there's accountability in knowing. There's accountability in a relationship. Okay? But throughout the Old Testament, people changed his name. And I would argue that we do the same thing now to avoid answering the question, who is Jesus? Or at least avoid having it be what informs our worldview. One of the names they had for God in the Old Testament, one of the oldest names for God in the Old Testament, is Elohim. And Elohim, the Hebrew word El, or El-Ol, translates into terrify. But by terrific, they mean powerful. Elohim means all powerful. Okay, and it's the first word for God. And it's not a bad description of God. He is all powerful. It's actually where the Muslims get Allah. El-Ol, Allah. El and El in the languages are the same. Okay, he's all powerful. Here's the problem. We like Elohim as a name for God instead of Yahweh. You know why? Because if he's all powerful, everything's his fault. This bad thing happened. Why did God let that happen? Okay, he didn't. We sinned and messed up the whole thing. Well, we don't have to take responsibility if he's in charge of everything. If he's all powerful and he's the puppeteer, well, it wasn't my fault. God did it. Okay, so it's an excuse for us not to be responsible or accountable. So we like all-powerful God. We like Elohim instead of Yahweh. Okay, how about Adonai? Adonai is another word for God that's used a lot in the Old Testament. And to make it simple, it's God, small g. Technically, it's Lord, small l. Like the Lord of a land. I'm the Lord of my family, right, honey? Yeah, small l, you know, okay? It's just a generic form of Lord or God, okay? And I believe that a lot of us do that. Oh, we admit that Jesus is God. Oh, he's God, along with my kids' sports schedule and money and vacation and me getting what I want and a whole bunch of other gods that we have on an equal term with Jesus. Okay, so that's Adonai. That's small L, Lord. Oh, he's God. More like he's a God. That's not healthy. It's not good. But the last one is my favorite. The last one is my favorite. Most of you have heard the name Jehovah for God. Well, something a lot of people don't know is Jehovah is a made-up name. Jehovah isn't really, if you look in the NIV, you don't see Jehovah anywhere. They translate it Yahweh. The Jews made up the word Jehovah. They took, in Hebrew, there are no vowels. There's just consonants. They put the vowels in only about 1,000 years ago because there were so few Jewish people in the world, they thought Hebrew was going to be a lost language. Okay, so they added the consonant sounds about 1,000 years ago. But they took the vowels from Yahweh and they added in the consonant sounds of Adonai, which just means Lord, small l, and they came up with Yehoah. So instead of saying Yahweh, they now changed it to Yehoah. That way they would never take the Lord's name in vain. They could swear all they wanted, but they wouldn't be cursing because it wasn't actually God's name. That makes a lot of sense, doesn't it? Not anything about the heart, just about what you do. Folks, we do the same thing. We make up the God that we want. I call it Disney God, okay? That's what we do. Oh, he's all powerful. He will bless me. But he's not going to make me do what he says. That's not the God that's in here. That might be your Jehovah. Might be your made-up God. But that's not real. Okay? Because when you really know who Jesus is, now you're accountable. So instead, I'm going to make one up that fits my desires. This isn't good. But the Jews have been doing it for thousands of years, and we still do it today. Why? Because we're sinful and we're broken. We want God to fit who we are. When we're trying to fit God into who we want him to be, that's idolatry. And it's no wonder that Jesus said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan." Okay? If you answer, if you know that Jesus is God in the flesh, and you know that he died to pay the price for your sins, that comes with accountability. Then it should drive how you live. It should change how you view the world. Okay? It should be the source of all of your thoughts, your feelings, your actions. Everything goes through that lens because that's my worldview. Okay? And it's hard. But what you believe here changes everything. Now, by the way, before we move on, I want to say Peter answered correctly. Peter gave the right answer. So, verse 31, it says, he then began to teach them. By the way, then, if you have an NIV, it's then. In other translations, it might be and, but in the Greek, it's kai. It basically says, because of the last conversation, this next conversation happened. Okay? He then began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and after 3 days rise again. He spoke plainly about this, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But when Jesus turned and looked at his disciples, he rebuked Peter. Get behind me, Satan, he said. You do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns. So Jesus takes the conversation. Who do you say I am? You're the Messiah. And he says, okay, let's see if you really understand what that means. He said, I'm going to die. And I have to because of the kingdom. But I'm going to rise again. Okay? He essentially puts the gospel right in their own context. He talks about the chief priests and the elders and the teachers of the law. He said, they're not doing it right. We're going to fix it, but they're going to kill me, and I'm going to rise again. He puts the gospel right into their context, and Peter doesn't get it. Peter basically says, nope, that's not right. Now, the question is why? I think there's two reasons that are possible. We know the reason for Peter. The only two reasons that you would know who Jesus is and not act is, number one, you don't have the whole picture. And we know how to get the whole picture. Almost every week I talk about Acts chapter 2. Okay, Acts chapter 2. The church, when it first began, focused on four things. Read your Bible, pray, go to church, and hang out with other Christians. If you do those things, God will fill you with the knowledge of God, of Jesus, that you can then act on. That's how we build up our faith. Those are the basic building blocks. Now, there's a lot more, but everything that he calls us to do flows out of those four basic building blocks. Read your Bible, go to church, pray, hang out with other Christians. It's super simple. It's in Acts chapter 4, or chapter 2. I preach it every week, okay? So if you don't have the whole picture, that's how you get it. That's the one reason that we would say to God, no, you're wrong, or not follow him if we know the truth. Okay, but the other thing, and I think that this is what Peter was doing, and I believe this because of the context. Peter was immersed with Jesus. Peter knew what was going on, but he wanted it his way. He had his own ideas, and he put those ahead of the things of God, okay? In other words, he wasn't applying the truth that he knows about Christ to his day-to-day life, and I think that is the most common for us. I think most of us understand that Jesus is who he said he is, but we don't allow it to dictate how we live. You know, I'll tell you a story. I didn't tell the story first service, and Mark Wise requested it. My wife will be thrilled. I remember when I first went to college, my wife got pregnant. I dropped out of college and opened a couple of businesses, okay? It was a difficult time in our life when we had little children and new businesses and no money, okay? Well, it was about that time that I got saved. And the idea of giving the church 10% when you can barely make enough to eat was a stretch for me as a new Christian. But I remember the conversations that we had, and I remember us thinking, if Jesus is who he said he is and we don't give, we're kind of dumb. Like, it just shapes what you do and what you think. If he can walk out of a tomb, he can find me more money, right? So let's just do what he says, okay? Folks, at the time, we owned a bowling pro shop. I have proved to you that God loves bowling. I never sold so many bowling balls. I'm not kidding. I think the year that I sold the bowling pro shop to go to work for someone else so that I could have insurance, and then I started going to school to be a minister. The year I sold the bowling pro shop, I sold $500,000 in merchandise. Bowling balls! Now, I didn't make that much money, obviously. I had employees, and I had... But God can bless whatever you put your hand to if you let who he is shape how you live. It's that simple. I know this almost seems too simple, but it's, is God who he says he is? Yes or no? Well, then what? Well, then I better do what he says. It's just that simple. And Peter, he doesn't apply that to day-to-day life. Jesus, I'm going to die. Well, I don't want you to die. The correct answer is, yes, sir. But Peter didn't get it. Why? Because he wasn't applying it to his day-to-day life. We would rather he enacted our plan. That's what we pray for. God, do this or do that. How about this? God, give me the strength to handle whatever you're going to do. Okay? These are different prayers because they come from different hearts and they come from different world views. And that worldview is shaped by who Jesus says he is and who he actually was. And when you get to the last verse, this is going to be an abrupt ending. And I am not telling you that you are all servants of Satan if you struggle, okay? But here's the bottom line. Peter, you know, Peter, the disciple who Jesus was going to build the church on, that Peter, if he had in mind the things that he wanted instead of in mind the things that God wanted, Jesus said, you're helping the devil. Folks, we have serious decisions to make. And when we willingly and purposely decide, even though I know who God is, I'm going to do something else, we give Satan a foothold. We give Satan a chink in God's armor that he can work on. Folks, there's two ways to fix this. We could either do nothing. We can just keep to ourselves and simplify it to the point that we just aren't really effective. Satan will leave us alone, I promise. Or we can aggressively and purposely do what God says to do. If we're doing that, he will honor it. If we're not, Satan's going to have a heyday. It's just that simple. Let's pray. Lord, help us. Help us not to give any of our time or our talents or our treasures to the evil one. Help us not to fight against your kingdom, even unwillingly and unknowingly, but help us rather, Lord, to be a part of the solution where we're building up the people around us, where we're being built up by you because we are living a life that shows that we know who Jesus is. Father, I know this is harsh and I know this is difficult to grab onto, that if we know we're doing something wrong, we're giving the devil a chance. Help us, Lord, to seek you out with all that we have so that your kingdom gets all the glory. We thank you. We praise you. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. In a minute, we're going to take communion. I want to remind you about the bulletins. On the back side of the bottom of the bulletins, there's a place for prayer requests or questions or anything you need. There's also a place for you to ask for help. If you need help growing in your faith, maybe there's something that you know, Satan's beating you up with, and you know, you need somebody to walk with you so you can heal from that or you can overcome that. That's what the body of Christ is for. But you have to take that first step. You've got to ask. Maybe you're sitting here and you don't really know anything about what it means to be a Christian. Maybe you're here for the first time. Ask. You know, we can't force you. We're not going to, I promise you, if I go to Tim Hortons with you, I will not make you accept Jesus. But I will tell you why and what the scripture says and how much God loves you. So wherever you're at in your faith walk, if we can help you, tell us, because that's what we're here for. And as we come to the communion table, it's pretty simple, really. You know, it wasn't long after this moment that Jesus confronted Peter that he said, At the Last Supper, this is my body and this is my blood, and this is what's going to happen for you. And you know, we talk about that being a model for us to follow. We talk about that being a model for us to live in with not only the sacrifice, but the power that came from that. But folks, remember, there's some accountability with that too. If Jesus was willing, if God died for you, how serious should we take this call to follow him, to take up our cross and follow him. Think about that as we remember what he was willing to do for us. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you. We thank you for the memorial that you give us. Help us, Lord, to give you thanks with it, but also, Lord, to use it to hold ourselves accountable. If we know you did this, we have a serious call. We have serious responsibility. Help us to fulfill those things, Lord, so that your kingdom can be glorified in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, as you know, each week when we take up an offering, we have somebody come up and do a little devotion and kind of tell you something about what's going on with what you offer with your money. A couple of weeks ago, we had a team of 12 people in the Dominican Republic, and they had a great trip, and I think one or two of them want to, just one. Angela's going to be lonely. Just one person is going to tell you some of the things your money was doing in the DR a couple of weeks ago.
Hi, everybody. I'm Angela Arbogast. I'm not going to lie to you. I'm not here just to tell you about where your money's been going, but I'm hoping that something I say might just prick your heart and convince at least somebody here to take a mission trip yourself. Because I can tell you, it's really a reciprocal relationship. You go down there to bless other people, and I promise you, the people that you interact with bless you just as much as anything you give to them. We experienced that time and time again. The 12 of us worked with four different groups of kids, about 20 to 30 kids in each group. Two of the groups we were able to do a VBS with three different times, which was awesome. But they humbled us in so many ways. I don't have enough time to tell you how many ways they humbled each of us. They have so, so little. And yet the tiniest thing you give them, they are just filled with gratitude. You don't see the brattiness in the children that you tend to sometimes see here, you know? The gimme, 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 the entitlement, none of that. Just, oh, wow, you're giving me this little tiny thing? Thank you so much. You know, Chad Golden had brought down a huge bag of fidget spinners, those little gadgets that kids were playing with here a couple years ago. And one of the little girls said, I still have mine from last year, you know? And they were so excited that he brought more. Just little things like that. But another thing is, if you've come to this church week after week and you feel like, you know, I don't feel like I'm connecting with anybody. I don't really know anyone deeply. They don't know me. Go on a mission trip. I promise you, you'll get to know them way better than you ever thought you would. The 12 of us just really had a wonderful, wonderful time together, bonding together, serving the Lord together. I had one heart-to-heart talk with one of the team members who was expressing to me that they felt unworthy to be on that trip. And, you know, it was a good time together just being able to say, no, look, I'm just as unworthy as you are. Every single one of us is. I mean, you look at the people in the Bible, you know, Abraham and King David and even Peter, like Pastor Jeff was talking about today, and none of them was perfect. Each one messed up in significant ways. And yet, it's not their worthiness that counts, it's his worthiness, you know. He uses us as vessels, we're imperfect vessels. So don't let that stop you. And even like the fear factor, I had so many people tell me, and I know other people on the team had folks tell them they were so scared about us going. I do have to let you know, it's kind of like having your mother-in-law find out that some people died in Toledo and say, ooh, you shouldn't be living in Steubenville, that's dangerous. I mean, it's that, like, okay, literally, we were here and the deaths were happening down here, on the completely opposite side of the country. So it was fine. Okay, so there's a few pictures. This little girl here, Mabel, profoundly disabled. I believe she has cerebral palsy, probably autism, I'm not sure what else. She's unable to do anything for herself, unable to sit up, feed herself, talk, anything. She would let out these screams, you know, the really unnerving kind of screams that a child who has those kind of problems will do. And the fleshly side of me wanted to run to the other side of the patio where we were meeting with these kids. This is at the orphanage. But, you know, I was like, I'm here for a reason, and it's not for me to be comfortable. So I just prayed, and I pushed past it, and I went over beside her. And I just started stroking her arm and just singing Jesus Loves Me to her in Spanish, because I speak Spanish, I teach Spanish. And you know, all the contortions and all the screaming stopped, and she smiled like that. And I took a picture, and it just blessed me to no end, you know, to see, like, I was like, this is why I'm here. And go ahead and turn it. This is the house, this is the orphanage that we were at, where that particular girl was. This is what your money has done. You see that on top of the roof? That's the solar paneling, which took their situation from having the electric cut off numerous times, even sometimes numerous times a day, and causing the kids in that orphanage who have asthma and have to have nebulizer treatments on a regular basis, and sometimes couldn't get their treatments because there was no electricity. That never happens now. And the financial burden that they were dealing with, well, their electric bill this month was $7. And sometimes the electric company pays them because their solar paneling is adding electric to the grid. So give yourselves a hand for that, because that's awesome. You know, so it's, and the next picture is the lady so Tracy Morelli is one of our congregation here. And on the right is Rosa. She's the dynamic, amazing woman who started that orphanage. They have, I think, 18 kids in the orphanage right now. She's mom to all of them. She has barely any help. And full of the Holy Spirit, just an absolutely wonderful, wonderful woman. That little chapel that they're standing in is just a tiny little building right beside the orphanage. And she told me, since I was able to speak to her in Spanish, she told me that a youth group from the church that we were connected with on our trip, a youth group came to serve, and one of the teenage boys saw this fruit tree loaded with fruit right there by the house, and he said, he got like goosebumps, and he said, God's going to do something mighty and powerful right in this spot. And she had no idea that there were already plans in place to build a chapel right there. Somebody who, you know, she wasn't in charge of that. Somebody else was building that chapel. And lo and behold, I think that same year, that tree was cut down. Different kind of fruit is being produced now in that spot. And Tracy asked me to ask her if a lot of people were coming to know Christ in that little chapel. And she said, oh my, yes. She said that they meet weekly, but they also once a month come in there at 9:30 at night, and they stay till 7:30 in the morning praising and worshiping nonstop. And she said people who are not believers come, and they just are overcome by the power of the Holy Spirit, and they come to know Christ. And this is happening over and over. This has been there now for 5 years, and just powerful things are happening. So that's happening too. And the next one, Neva Wise. She was one of the ones on the trip. I didn't ask her permission to show that. I hope she's okay with that. But she was so precious, along with Leah Pennington and my daughter Lydia, who is serving in the nursery today, but she's 17, and it's kind of cool because my very first mission trip was when I was 17, so I was really thrilled to get to have her with me. But that's just such a perfect sample or example of what happened that whole week. Just kids loving on us. I mean, honestly, we would go prepared to do things for them. Like, actually, I think the next picture, is there one more or not? There was another picture where there's this little girl, she's gotten some face paint done, and then you see she's painting me. And this is what they did. Like, whatever we had prepared to do for them, they got so much more joy doing it for us, you know? So if we planned to face paint them, they were face painting us. If we planned to do their hair and stuff for them, they sat us down, they grabbed me, Leah, Lydia, Geneva, and had us all lined up, and they were doing our hair, and I mean, they gave us some crazy hairdos, but it didn't matter. They were just so thrilled to just, like, you know, the whole, it's better to give than to receive? They embodied that time and time again. Blessed us to no end. So I can't thank you enough for all of you who contributed and helped make that possible and are contributing to what's happening down there. And I just, with all my heart, urge you to take a trip like that in the coming years, because it will change you forever. Thanks. I will. Lord, we thank you for the gifts that we're about to receive. I just pray that you will bless them, bless the heart and the life of each person who gives. And I pray that you'll take this money and that your will be done here and abroad. In Jesus' name, amen.
Church today. A couple of things before we get out of here. First of all, there's a woman's class. Excuse me, sorry. Starting tomorrow, and you can come here for it, or you can live stream it in your house. We're really excited about the live stream thing. We had a lot of luck with that. We started that a couple classes ago, but it's a great opportunity for us to build some fellowship and maybe some small groups if there's people that you know that might benefit from this but might not want to come to the church. Have them at your house, three or four people in a house. The curriculum is downloadable, and everything will be available on live stream. So it's a great opportunity. If you have questions about that, you can call the church or get on the church website, and it will give you instructions for that. So that is What's in the Word. It's a ladies' class coming up in July. Also, the church picnic is 2 weeks from yesterday, July 20th. We're having a cornhole tournament, and what else? Oh, adult child relays. Praise the Lord. I was panicked last service and thought it was going to be an eating contest. None of you need to see me like that. So adult child relays and cornhole tournament, it'll be from 10 to 2 at Jim Wood Park in Steubenville on July 20th. Always a good time. So, but you do need to sign up for that so we know how many to cook for, because we buy the meat for that. We buy the hamburgers and the hot dogs, but out on in the lobby is a sign-up sheet, and next to the sign-up sheet, it tells you what to bring. Based on the starting letter of your last name, you'll bring something different. So check that out as you sign up. We do have VBS and a kindergarten through fourth grade volleyball camp. Both of those are at the end of this month, so you can call the church to sign up for either one of those. The volleyball camp is July 24th, 25th, 26th. VBS is the next week, July 29th through, and they're both 9 to noon. So if you have kids in that age group and you want to, you can sign up. I think there's information to sign up for the VBS out in the lobby, but the volleyball camp you'll have to call the church to sign up for. And then one last thing before we get out of here. On Saturday nights, starting next Saturday, there is a biblical financial concepts class. If you want to know what the Bible teaches about how to manage your money, this is the class for you. I know Saturday nights is difficult, but you can come to church Saturday nights for a few weeks. It's kind of cool. So it is Saturday night, 6:15, right after service. Elder Mark Wise went through it a couple of months ago, and the 12 or 13 people who were in there said it was amazing. So if you need help kind of figuring out what the Bible says about your money, there's a great opportunity to learn about that. So, all right. Whew, it's summer. Things are supposed to be slow. By the way, well, one more thing I just thought of. Please keep camp in your prayers. We are in charge of a 4th through 6th grade camp, and when I say we, I completely mean Eric Yoho, our children's minister. I'm not going to camp. But 4th through 6th grade camp is this week. It starts tonight, and it's a big deal. A lot of people from this church out there sponsoring and serving and helping the kids. So they've had as many as 100 kids, so it'll be a fun week. So out at Elkhorn. So keep them in your prayers. Let's pray. Lord, we just thank you. We thank you for all the stuff that's going on because, Lord, we're reaching people. And last week, Lord, we fixed up a bunch of homes, and this week we heard about what's going on in the DR. Lord, we know that there's been lots of trips this year, and there's lots of opportunities for us to serve. And we just thank you. We thank you that you continue to use us, Lord. Father, we want to give you glory with all that we have. And Lord, I know that if we know who you are, we believe who you are, Father, then that should shape how we live. And if we're doing that, if we honor you that way, Lord, I know not only will you bless us, but you'll use us and we'll get to see the benefits and the growth and the joy in this community because of your word and your spirit working through us. We just thank you for the opportunity. We give you all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen.